This is Duke University.
Thank you. Grace and peace to you in the name of Jesus Christ, and welcome to worship this morning. I'd like to tell you about a few activities in the life of the chapel coming up. There will be a special interfaith panel titled September 11th, 2001 to 2011, How Have Faith Communities Responded? Sponsored by the Faith Council and Duke Divinity School, the speakers will include Sam Wells, Abdullah Antepli, Sumi Kim, Laura Lieber, and Richard Hayes. The panel will take place Wednesday, September 7th at 7:30 p.m. in Westbrook 0016. Please join us. If you are an undergraduate student worshiping with us today, we hope you'll take notice of the list of fall semester discernment groups in your bulletin. These are offered by Duke Chapel Student Ministries. We have a number of wonderful groups this semester, and they are an opportunity to meet other students, get to know chapel staff, and reflect on the ways that God is at work here on campus in Durham and beyond. Lastly, there was so much enthusiasm after last week's student lunch, we have decided to offer Loco Pops again. If you are an undergraduate student, please join us on the lawn just after worship for Loco Pops. It's a chance to meet other students and meet some chapel staff and find out more about how you can be involved in the life of this chapel. Let everything that has breath praise the Lord. Please stand and join our opening hymn.
Thank you. God's heart is set on us, and he desires our flourishing. We come before him to open our fractured lives to God's forgiving grace. Let us now offer our confession to God and each other. Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry, and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your name. Amen. May the God of all healing and forgiveness draw you to himself, cleanse you from all your sins, and strengthen you to live in the power of the Holy Spirit all of your days. In the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. As we experience the forgiveness of our God, let us share signs and words of Christ's peace.
Please join me in the prayer for illumination, which is printed in your bulletin. God of glory, the end of our searching, as we are formed by your word, help us to lay aside all that prevents us from seeking your kingdom, and inspire us to give ourselves to seeking the pearl beyond all price. Through our Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. The appointed psalm for today is Psalm 150, found on page 862 of your hymnal. The Gloria is printed in your bulletin. Please remain seated and sing the psalm and Gloria responsively.
Praise the Lord, praise God in his sanctuary. Praise God for his mighty deeds. Praise God with trumpet sound. Praise God with tambourine and dance. Praise God with sounding cymbals. Let everything that breathes praise the Lord. Glory be to the Father and to the Son. As it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be.
The New Testament lesson is from Romans, the 13th chapter. Owe no one anything except to love one another, for the one who loves another has fulfilled the law. The commandments, you shall not commit adultery, you shall not murder, you shall not steal, you shall not covet, and any other commandment are summed up in this word, love your neighbor as yourself. Love does no wrong to a neighbor, therefore love is fulfilling of the law. Besides this, you know what time it is, how it is now the moment for you to wake from sleep. For salvation is nearer to us than when we became believers. The night is far gone, the day is near. Let us then lay aside the works of darkness and put on the armor of light. Let us live honorably as in the day, not in reveling and drunkenness, not in debauchery and licentiousness, not in quarreling and jealousy. Instead, put on the Lord Jesus Christ and make no provision for the flesh to gratify its desires. This is the word of the Lord.
The gospel lesson is from Matthew, the 18th chapter. Then Jesus told his disciples, "If another member of the church sins against you, go and point out the fault when the two of you are alone. If the member listens to you, you have regained that one. But if you are not listened to, take one or two others along with you, so that every word may be confirmed by the evidence of two or three witnesses. If the member refuses to listen to them, tell it to the church. And if the offender refuses to listen even to the church, let such a one be to you as a Gentile and a tax collector. Truly I tell you, whatever you bind on earth will be bound in heaven, and whatever you loose on earth will be loosed in heaven. Again, truly I tell you, if two of you agree on earth about anything you ask, it will be done for you by my Father in heaven. For where two or three are gathered in my name, I am there among them." This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you. In the name of the living God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. Please be seated. The Pre-Raphaelite painting, The Death of Chatterton, appears on the front cover of your bulletin, and you might want to take a close look at it as I begin the sermon. It's an archetypal image of what it means to be an artist. Thomas Chatterton, a poet and native of my hometown, Bristol, England, dies in London in 1770, aged 17, penniless, desperate, and alone. His clothes are bohemian and raffish. His art is seldom understood and scarcely ever appreciated. His talent is enormous, and in this tiny garret apartment, he has clearly had spurts of breathtaking and rapid creativity. Yet the scraps of torn paper demonstrate his tortured struggle. We vividly see the contrast between the intensity of his life's purpose and the terrible waste brought about by his poverty and lack of critical acclaim. The painting is telling us to be an artist is to be possessed, impassioned, alone, tragic, and tortured, but nonetheless glorious and beautiful. Why then would anyone want to be an artist? What got it into the minds of the leaders of our university to make transforming the arts the fifth of its six strategic goals for Duke? The answer is that art is not simply tortured and lonely and tragic. Art is the threshold you cross as soon as you move from the indicative of what things are to the subjunctive of what things could be. From grabbing something in one hand to use it, to cherishing something in two hands truly to enjoy it. From regarding an abundance of meanings as exasperating and perplexing, to seeing plurality of possibility and interpretation as joyful and life-giving. Art is not so much the production of distinguished artifacts or even the experience of profound creativity. Art is what happens within a triangle of forms, media, and ideas. For example, the form might be a landscape, the medium might be a watercolor, while the idea might be the healing goodness of living things. Within the triangle of form, medium, and idea lies a myriad of possibilities, and art refers not just to acts of creation, but also to moments of appreciation and interpretation and revised understanding. Artists are those who live their lives within that triangle of forms, media, and ideas, refining their skills, understanding their tradition, enjoying the interplay of genres, and finding new ways to configure and present them. A true artist is not so much one who dies a tragic, tortured, histrionic death, as one who embodies the disciplines of their craft so as to make it a way of life, and whose art evokes imaginative constructions, fertile conversations, and engaged responses in the lives of its audience. These are all the reasons that art, in its many forms, belongs at the heart of a university. But what does the Christian faith have to bring to this world of art? How does an undergraduate or graduate student, drawn into this triangle of form, medium, and idea, come to understand a calling to be a visual, literary, or performance artist, and continue to see that calling within their Christian vocation as a whole. 5 centuries ago, the theologian John Calvin described the ministry of Christ as a threefold office. Calvin looked at the three roles for which persons were anointed in Old Testament times. The roles were those of prophet, priest, and king. Calvin described how Jesus exercised all three of these offices, as prophet, especially in his life, as priest, especially in his death, and as king, especially in his resurrection. I'd like to explore with you today what it might mean for an artist to exercise these three roles, or perhaps more collectively, for the arts in general, to carry this threefold purpose in our society and particularly at this university. Many artists today can readily identify with the role of the prophet. What a prophet does is to hold a mirror up to a society or an individual and ask, "Are you proud of what you see?" A prophet recalls the founding commitments of a person or a body of people and asks, "Have those commitments been honored?" A prophet casts a dream of what it might mean for a person or society to fulfill their true potential and says, "Look, here is the painful gap between ideal and reality." Artists are drawn to all of these roles. A prophet says, "Let's see what this looks like upside down. I wonder how life would be if all the light shone from the back. Let's imagine we hear this baritone several times, but each time it becomes more threatening or more mysterious." Prophets challenge, reconfigure, expose, highlight, ridicule, and shock. That's what artists do. Sometimes when an artist's ideas stick outside the triangle and leave the form and media behind, or when the medium is so distressing it obscures the form and ideas almost altogether, art becomes notorious for upset and scandal. The offended people who crowd in to condemn the artist or art in general at such a moment have often forgotten or never appreciated that artists are prophets. Prophets often shock people too. Jesus shocked people with his prophetic actions of cleansing the temple and healing on the Sabbath. Not all offensive actions are prophetic, but some prophetic actions are offensive. And just because an artifact offends some people, that doesn't inherently mean that it's not art. It just means it's testing the boundaries of idea or medium. 3 years ago, this chapel staged a performance of Benjamin Britten's War Requiem. Britten was a pacifist, and he weaves the bitter and ironic poetry of Wilfred Owen with the traditional words of the Latin Mass. Britten's composition is a prophetic work of art. It shocks some, transforms many, and moves almost everyone. It asks 2 questions. How can we live with the Christian faith after all this horror? And how can we live without it? That's what prophets do. The second role of the artist is to be a priest. The poet George Herbert says, "A man that looks on glass, on it may stay his eye, or if he pleaseth, through it pass, and then the heaven espy." But just imagine if that glass is stained glass. Just imagine if that glass is the music of Bach or the painting of Giotto or the poetry of Shakespeare. For the artist, every work of art is an icon through which the observer can look and see ultimate truth profound wisdom, the heart of God. The artist strives to approximate that epitome of all things and hopes that the audience will, at least in its imagination, transcend whatever limitations there are in the work or performance or presentation and see beyond even what the artist can see, see beyond the horizon, beyond the stars. In a general way, this is what Christians mean by the notion of a sacrament. In a sacrament, a priest takes the ordinary stuff of life, bread or water, and makes it speak of heaven. A sacrament lies at the intersection of actions and words, where the presence of God is felt or tasted or touched in the faithfulness of what takes place and the way it imitates the pattern and character of God. An artist takes the ordinary stuff of earth, wood or metal or canvas, and makes it speak or sing of the divine. It's a priestly role. When you listen to the trailers for a classical music station, you'd be forgiven that classical composers throughout the centuries have really been in the therapy business, and that Mozart, Beethoven, and the rest devoted their lives to making background accompaniments to bubble baths and foot massages. But this simply reflects the way our society has transformed priests into therapists and therapists into priests. The point is that Mozart and Beethoven roll back the gates of heaven and bring us face to face with God, and that's a priestly role. When you stop believing in God, you still know you want what Mozart and Beethoven give you, but you don't want to call it God. So you call it soothing or searing. But that's just because you don't trust the word holy. Artists are high priests of creation. They gather around them all the fruits of creation, just as a priest does around an altar, and orders those gifts in such a way as to show the divine in the human and the earthly. That's what priests do. And then there's the artist as king. By king, I don't mean being in charge. I mean showing what humanity can do when it fulfills its potential. The architecture of Duke Chapel is kingly art, full of majesty and splendor. The brass of today's music is inclined towards the kingly dimension of art, especially when on Easter Day it explodes with joy over the wonder of Christ's resurrection. Kingly art is art that thrills and delights and excites and enthralls, art that stretches our imaginations to their limit in exaltation and awe and delirious rejoicing. I want to tell you about one of my most treasured encounters with kingly art. 20 years ago, when I first started out as a priest in the Church of England, I lived in a town that was both large enough and small enough to have its own road sweeper. When the truck had gone down every street, spraying and blowing and sweeping, the road sweeper followed with his cart full of brushes and buckets and hoses. I would pass the gruff and heavy-set road sweeper many days of the week as I walked around the town doing home visits. And we would exchange respectful monosyllables of mutual acknowledgement. One day, I got a call to say an elderly woman in the parish had died. I headed to her home, where I was told her son would greet me. Her son, who did indeed greet me, turned out to be the road sweeper. He sat me down and wept as he mourned his mother, and we planned the funeral together. "What keeps you going?" I dared to ask, as I viewed his bare apartment, now even emptier without the presence of his elderly mother. "These," he said, sweeping his hand across a swathe of videotapes, covering the wall from floor to ceiling. I thought it might be great boxing matches of the 1980s, or maybe classic truck and trailer escapades of all time. But I was wrong. "Opera," he said, with a tear in his eye. I suddenly thought, "You mean Oprah." And I pondered how a talk show hostess from Mississippi could cross the Atlantic with such ease and stir the heart and soul of a road sweeper. Maybe, I speculated, he and his mother had watched Oprah's shows together. "Opera," he said, again with his throaty voice. "This is my glory." And I looked closely, and opera it was. Verdi, Puccini, Mozart, Rossini, Bellini, Strauss, Wagner, Stravinsky, the Magic Flute, the Ring Cycle, La Traviata, every opera you've ever heard of was on those shelves. "This is my glory," he said, with tears falling down his cheeks. Here was a man who spent his life in the gutter and had just lost maybe the only person that had ever loved him. And he was showing me where to find beauty. And I heard a voice in me saying, "Dust we are, but we are dust that dreams." That's the kingly power of art. We've just sung together the 150th Psalm. Psalm 150 is a resounding celebration of the kingly dimension of art. It's a call to pull out all the organ stops, and as the conductors like to say in rehearsal, play it once more with feeling. There's also a subtle prophetic message there, because there's nothing elitist about this psalm. On the contrary, it's determinedly inclusive. It's a psalm about what art is like in heaven, what the psalm calls God's mighty firmament. In heaven, the music is joined by men who in ancient Israelite culture traditionally would play trumpet, lute, harp, and cymbals, and also by women who traditionally would join with dance and tambourine. In the final line, everything that has breath, every single creature on earth, joins the heavenly chorus. Here is a prophetic statement that art may be the realm of genius, but it also has its democratic moments. Perhaps more even than the kingly and prophetic dimensions, Psalm 150 is profoundly priestly, because it's fundamentally a call to worship. The whole psalm is about the wonder of God and the infectious character of celebrating God's glory. The word praise occurs 13 times in 6 verses. Every instrument, every person, and in the end, every living thing on earth discovers its ultimate purpose in glorifying and enjoying God forever. This is the crescendo that brings the hymn book of Israel and the church to a rousing conclusion. And that's the discovery that lies at the heart of a Christian notion of art and of what it means to Christians that a university like Duke has decided art is going to be at the center of its identity. Art is finally about glory. Artists fundamentally construct acts of worship. They may be so prophetic that their bitterness and irony are more about lament than praise, but lament is still a form of worship. They may be so ordered and bumptious that it seems to be more about cleverness or vainglory than genuine exaltation, but vainglory is merely a distorted form of worship. The artist strains for what cannot be said, cannot be expressed, cannot be contained in conventional forms. It cannot be contained because it's from God, and God cannot be contained or fathomed or comprehended. That's why art is exhausting, compelling, and ultimately fundamental to human existence. Art is where we imitate the nature of God in the excess of energy that created the universe, the exquisite miniature that constituted the incarnation, the harrowing agony that underwent the cross, the restorative joy that burst out in the resurrection, and the dance of delight that caught fire at Pentecost. Because God is the great artist. And each human life is an event of recognition, interpretation, and improvisation on the wondrous imagination of God. Are you an artist? According to Psalm 150, you are. Is there a yearning in you to express the depths, the ache, the fury, the glory? Are you a prophet seeking truth and a closer social embodiment of it? Are you a priest rolling back the veil between heaven and earth? Are you a king rousing all creation to its potential and praise? Are you allowing the Holy Spirit to make you into a work of art that turns all creation into Alleluia?
Pathways continues to be an expanding core ministry of Duke Chapel, with nearly 50 chapel scholars, numerous summer interns, discernment group participants, mission group participants, and others. Today we focus on our 2011-2012 Pathways Chapel Fellows, Janice Brown, Mark Thiesel, and Peter Farmer, who have committed to live together in Christian community and uphold the Pathways household covenant of daily prayer, weekly meals, fellowship, service, and friendship in Durham. As you'll notice by reading their bios printed in your bulletin, they are 2011 Duke graduates. Since the Pathways household, or the Pathways house, was renovated in 2006, we have had 20 fellows to serve in Durham and in our community. Please join us as we bless them, commission them, and bless our friends and companions in the West End. As Pathways Chapel Fellows, all of you have made a year-long commitment to explore vocation through relationship and community in the West End, residential community in the West End. Together, you have committed to a year of vocational exploration through engagement in nonprofit and ministry settings in Durham. Peter, Mark, Janice, is this your understanding of the role to which you have been called? It is. The Lord bless you with courage, faith, and mutual forbearance as you seek to know God and make God known. They are joined this year in residence by Duke seniors Leanna Lau and Sharon Palm-Ranke, who I invite up at this time, as well as a Duke graduating senior, class of 2011, Kia Pape, who is serving in the Office of Durham and Regional Affairs as a Robert K. Steele Community Engagement Fellow. We also invite up others who are our friends and loved ones and companions who are here with them and celebrate with us, share with us in their journey together in Christian community.
At Duke Chapel, we celebrate those in the Durham community who long for reconciliation and social healing. Here today are many who care deeply about the West End and surrounding neighborhoods and are allowing their lives to be gently transformed by new friendships. Today, we renew our commitment to journey together. Do you believe God is at work in the West End? Loving God, give us grace to meet you in one another and teach us to walk in your footsteps day by day. Amen. Amen.
The Lord be with you. Let us pray. Inexhaustible God, out of the darkness you created a beautiful world and called it good. Make us artists who yearn to praise you with every breath. Rouse us to fulfill our true potential. Offer your hope to those Christian artists who yearn to create something beautiful and who labor in witness to your work. We bring to you any who are trapped in struggle, especially those for whom addiction, poverty, and depression are barriers to creative joy. Be present with those who long for beauty in relationships, work, or education, and transform our despair into dreams. Make us, Lord, high priests of creation who praise your mighty deeds in dance and song. Lord, in your mercy. Thrilling God, you enliven us with your presence when we gather in your name. Stretch our prophetic imaginations and make us people willing to seek and speak difficult truths. Reshape our minds and hearts to love our neighbors as you love us. Grant wisdom and patience to all those who live in intentional Christian community, especially the Chapel Pathways Fellows. Hold close to your heart our friends in the West End neighborhood. Comfort any in Durham who are separated from family, friends, and close companions. We pray especially for those who are isolated by prison walls, the barriers of broken relationships, or the burdens of mental illness. In a moment of quiet, we ask for your restorative love in a place in our lives in need of healing. Meet us, Lord, in our solitude, and help us find you in one another. Lord, in your mercy. Loving God, in your Holy Spirit, you bring our salvation ever nearer. Give us grace to live honorably and comfort us in our hours of darkness. Open our eyes to any who are trapped in feelings of jealousy or enmity. cherish all who struggle with addiction, and draw near to those who feel enslaved to the gratification of desire. We name before you those parts of our world whose people may feel ignored in the midst of their suffering. We remember all struggling with unemployment and homelessness. We name the people of the East Coast who continue to pick up the pieces of their lives after damage to their homes and communities. We remember all in Libya, Syria, and Yemen as they live in the midst of political and religious upheaval. Hold close to your heart people in all corners of your world who long for peace and safety. Shape us, Lord, to be a people of honor and humility who joyfully witness to your reconciling love. Lord, in your mercy. God, who is near us on our lips and in our hearts, guide us to know you more deeply and serve you more fully, that our every breath might praise your holy name, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. Students, a quick reminder that if you have not already done so, please fill out the white interest cards in your bulletin so we may be in touch with you to tell you more about opportunities to participate in the life of Duke Chapel. Today's offering will go to the Chapel Development Fund, which contributes to the care and preservation of this majestic building. This morning, the conclusion of the offertory anthem will take the place of the doxology. The director of music will indicate when it is time for the congregation to stand. Let us make all creation and all our lives a sacrifice to the praise of God.
If you are here today with a person or an issue that weighs heavily on your heart, there will be ministers in the Memorial Chapel during the sharing of communion, and they will be happy to pray with you. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
Lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. We glorify and enjoy you now and forever, gracious God, because you created the universe as your work of art and set us in the midst of it. When the canvas of your kindness was torn by our sin, you crafted a work of even more depth and beauty from the damage we had done. In Israel, you drew out a song of thankfulness and praise. And in your church, you give us voices to sing and dance and sculpt and inscribe the wonders of your love. And so we rejoice with the angels and archangels and all the company of heaven, singing the hymn of your unending praise. Hearts to you, Lord God, because you draw your whole creation into the celebration of your glory. Send down your Holy Spirit upon us now, that every part of every one of us might become an instrument of your peace. Give us your very self in these gifts of bread and wine, and make them be for us the body and blood of your Son, Jesus Christ, who on the night he gave himself up for us, took bread, gave thanks to you, gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat, this is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." When the supper was over, he took the cup, gave thanks to you, gave it to his disciples and said, "Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." Great is the mystery of faith. God of justice, make us a prophetic people whose every work and every act is a proclamation of the new order found in you and worthy of your kingdom. Holy God, make us a priestly people whose lives are so transparent with your truth that we become a place of encounter between you and your beloved children. Reigning God, make us a kingly people whose hearts are filled with worship and wonder, and who seek to bring every one of your gifts to fruition in the power of your Spirit. We pray in union with Christ in the power of your Holy Spirit, God of glory, forever and ever. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory. In his broken body, Jesus rolled back heaven that we might come face to face with God. Come to this sacred table, not because you are strong, but because you are weak. Come not because of your own goodness, but because you desire mercy. Come because you love the Lord a little, and would like to love him more. Come because the Lord loves you and gave himself up for you. Come, taste and see that the Lord is good. Please stand. Lord of all mercy, we have felt and tasted and touched your presence at this holy table. We give you thanks for artists who provoke and transform and delight. We name before you the Duke Dance Department and the gift of embodied art in movement and dance. Transform our bodies, our lives, and all creation into alleluias that sing your praises and point to your glory. We pray all these things through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. This service has ended, but our life in Jesus Christ goes on and on. Go now into the world in his name. May your light so shine and your joy be so obvious that all who see you will come to praise Christ. Go in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.